Again, what we're doing is we're taking a look at how a cell uses the information on DNA in order to make a protein. What we've just seen is that this is actually a two-step process. So the first step is that the cell reads the information on DNA in order to make a messenger RNA molecule in a process called transcription. The second step of making a protein is that the messenger RNA then goes to the ribosome where it's directly used in order to make a protein, and that process is called translation. What we just looked at is how transcription happens, and so what we'll do now is we'll take a look at how translation occurs. Before we look at the details though, we'll just give you a general idea of what translation involves. So again, the goal of translation is to make the protein, and in order to make the protein, what the cell reads directly in order to do that is this messenger RNA molecule. You might remember that proteins are made up of a bunch of amino acids that are just strung together. And so another way of thinking about translation is that it's a process where a cell uses the information on a messenger RNA in order to figure out what sequence of amino acids should get strung together in order to make a protein. It turns out that when a cell reads a messenger RNA molecule, the way it reads it is it reads it three nucleotides at a time. So it actually reads each set of three adjacent nucleotides, and it's each one of these sets, so it's each set of three nucleotides that encodes for a particular type of amino acid. So that, again, that's how basically a cell reads that messenger RNA. It's each set of three that encodes for one particular type of amino acids. These set of three nucleotides that encode for a particular amino acid, they're called codons. Right? So again, in words, codons are, they're found on messenger RNAs, and what they do is that they encode for a particular type of amino acid, and there's three nucleotides found in one codon. So that's generally how a cell uses the information on messenger RNA in order to make a protein. What we'll do next is we'll show you more of the details. But before we do that, how about if we mention that someone has actually figured out about 65 years ago exactly which amino acid each one of these codons encode for. So if you think about messenger RNA, there are four types of nucleotides found within it, right? There's A's, U's, G's, and C's. Codons are made up of three adjacent nucleotides. So if you think of how many different ways can you string together three letters if there are a total of four, turns out that there are 64 possible ways to do that. And again, someone has figured out what amino acid each one of the 64 codons encodes for. And so that information is contained within this thing right here. It's the genetic code. And again, every single codon that's out there, every three-letter combinations of U's and A's and C's are listed within this table. And also listed within this table is exactly what amino acid each codon encodes for. So for example, if you're interested in finding out what the codon AAU encodes for, you just look that up in this table, and it says here that AAU, whenever the cell sees that on a messenger RNA, that encodes for the amino acid asparagine. You can see by looking at this table that each amino acid can be encoded for by more than one codon. So for example, the amino acid leucine, that will be inputted into the messenger RNA whenever the cell sees any one of these four different types of codons. And so we'll see the significance of that starting next week. So why is it significant that multiple codons can encode actually for the same amino acid? One thing we'll point out about this table now, though, is this. So notice that one of the codons, AUG, it's considered to be a start codon. And that's because basically translation begins whenever the cell runs across this AUG codon. So another way of saying that is that if you consider all of the proteins that a cell makes, AUG encodes for methionine. AUG also happens to be the start codon. So the very first amino acid found in all of the proteins that a cell makes initially, the very first amino acid is methionine. It turns out that cells eventually can take off that methionine that's at the start and replace it with something else. But when a protein is first built, all proteins, when they're all first built inside of a cell, they all have the amino acid methionine at the beginning. And again, the reason why is because the codon that encodes for it, AUG, also happens to signal where translation should begin. Right? That's why it's called the start codon. Along the same lines, if there's a start codon, you might deduce that there's also stop codons. And it turns out that there are three different stop codons. So whenever a cell runs across any of these, UAA, UAG, or UGA, those all tell the cell this is where the protein ends. So this is where you should stop doing translation. But again, the bottom line here is that someone has figured out what each of the 64 codons encodes for in terms of what amino acid it encodes for. So now we'll take a look at more of the details as far as how translation happens. How is a messenger RNA read in order to make a protein? So here are all of the things that are required in order for translation to happen. And so I kind of think of translation like baking, right? So whenever you bake like cookies or something, you need certain things in order to bake cookies. And so those same basic things are needed in order for a cell to make a protein. So if you think about what all is needed in order to bake cookies, you need a kitchen in order to do the baking. You need a recipe. You need someone to go get the ingredients, right, to make the cookies. So you need someone to go to the grocery store, get all the eggs and the flour and the sugar in order to bake the cookies. You need the ingredients themselves. It might be useful to have a timer, right? So if you're making many batches of cookies, it might be useful to have a timer to let you know when the baking time is up. So when you should take the cookies out of the oven and put the new batch in. And also, it might be helpful if you're going to maybe bribe someone to go to the grocery store to get the recipes and bring them back to the kitchen. It might be helpful to give them some food, right? Because that's kind of tiring to keep going to the grocery store and pick up stuff. So it would be useful to have some food for that person so that they don't stop doing their job. All right, so all of those things are needed in order to bake cookies. Those same types of things are needed in order for a cell to make a protein. So again, here are all the things that are needed in order to make a protein. And so what we'll do next is identify what all of these things are and generally tell you what they all do. So this here represents the messenger RNA. And again, the messenger RNA was made during transcription. And what the messenger RNA does, it's kind of like the recipe for making cookies, except that what it's the recipe for here is the recipe that tells a cell how to make a particular type of protein. Right, so you need instructions, you need the recipe in order to make a protein. Another thing that's needed in order to make a protein, well, just like in baking a cookie, you need the actual place to do it. Right? You need a kitchen in order to bake the cookies. So same thing when proteins are being made. You need the actual physical place in order to make it. And that physical place is the ribosome. So the ribosome is kind of like the kitchen in that it's the place where the proteins are actually made. One thing to mention about ribosomes is that if you consider each individual ribosome, it's actually made up of two parts. It's made up of a big part and a small part. And so, in other words, it's made up of a large subunit and a small subunit. If you're considering what is a ribosome made of, so what's the stuff that makes up the ribosomes in your cell? It turns out that ribosomes are made up of a mixture of proteins and RNA. It's made up of a type of RNA called ribosomal RNA, or rRNA. And again, the reason why it's called ribosomal RNA is because it's RNA that's used to, it's RNA that's found in ribosomes.